Good evening, everyone. It's time for us to begin our PM worship. Glad to see you all with us tonight. Welcome to our visitors. I thought I heard a chime already, so appreciate everybody checking their phones to make sure they're set to silent mode or vibrate. If you're visiting with us and haven't already done so, please fill out a card on the back of the pew in front of you and place it in the black box, contribution box, hanging on the wall near the door in the foyer. We will begin our worship with a prayer. Heavenly Father, we're so grateful to you, dear God, for being our Father, for being our Creator, for being the King of our lives, Father. We thank you so much for the blessings that we enjoy. Spiritual blessings, Father, that you give us through your Son, through being in his church, the hope of eternal life that we have through him and the sacrifice he made on the cross for us. Father, we also thank you so much for the physical blessings that we enjoy, each of us with the measure of health that we have. Father, we in some cases wish we could be better, but Father, we know that no matter what our situation is, if we dedicate our lives to serving you with all of our heart, mind, soul, and strength, that you will be pleased with what we're doing, that you will be pleased with our efforts to spread your kingdom throughout this area and throughout the world. I pray, Father, that we do our best in all aspects of our lives to serve you. We pray, Father, you will please be with this congregation as we strive to be sound, to evangelize in the local area, to reach those who have a heart to obey the gospel. We pray, Father, you'll please bless us with the wisdom and the knowledge that it takes to reach them on the level that they need to hear it. We pray, Father, you'll please be with the leaders of this country as they are so often divided on so many political issues, Father. We pray that in the end that they will make decisions that foster peace so that the gospel can be spread. Father, we pray that as we continue this worship service to you tonight, that our hearts and minds will be pure and that we will do our best to focus on the things that we're about to say and do. Have mercy on us, Father, and please help us to be found faithful in that day of judgment. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
And if you will, please turn to number 119. We'll sing the first three verses, number 119. Tempted and tried, we're often to wonder why it should be thus all the day long, while there are others living about us, never molested, though in the farther along we'll know all about it. Farther along we'll understand why. Cheer up, my brother, sing. As we drink for the beautiful gate, Father, our long will know about it. Father, our long will understand why. Cheer up, my brother, live in the sunshine. We'll understand it all by and by. All right, if you will now turn to number 302. And you may want to go ahead and mark number 718. We'll, after the singing on number 302, we'll have the scripture reading, then the lesson for the evening, and then we'll sing number 718. But right now, number 302, Far and Near. Far and near, the fields are teeming with the waves of ripened grain. Far and near, when the sun's last rays are gleaming near, them gather everywhere. Lord of harvest, send forth reapers, hear us, Lord, to thee we cry. Send them now the sheaves to gather in the harvest time.
Our scripture reading for tonight is from 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 to 10. 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 to 10. This is from the New King James Version. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon him, for he cares for you. Be sober, be vigilant. Because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world. But may the God of all grace, who called us to his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you.
Good to be back with you again here this evening. Good to see everyone here. I hope you have your Bibles open to 1 Peter 5. We will be looking at that text this evening. But I've got to begin by saying that You know, last week I brought up this subject of pride and put as the indicator that we were going to talk about it again, that it said lesson one of two on the title. I think we got some feedback from several, and it sparked some discussions here and there. And, you know, pride, I found out, can be a subject that is touchy at best, and maybe even controversial in some ways. And, you know, by the lesson title, you know, entitling it The Two Sides of Pride, it gives away the thought that I have on it. Yes, there is an evil side of pride. There is an ungodly. There is a side of pride that is not good, but maybe there is a good side. Well, hopefully we'll be able to see what that good side is tonight. I know I introduced it a little bit last week, that it is the side of humility, not boasting in ourselves of what we've been able to do ourselves, but boasting in God, what He has done through us as His servants. You know, it is not giving any credit to ourselves, but is getting all credit and all glory to God. Hopefully that'll be a little more clear tonight. But I want to make sure that it can never be said that what we say here and what we study here as a group is ambiguous, and that we leave any room for doubt. I want to be very clear tonight, as we look into the subject more of pride, that this, again, is something that we must rid ourselves of. Looking at the definition of pride, what it is traditionally defined as, and also looking at the instances that is mentioned in Scripture, this is something that we must definitely get rid of in our lives. You know, I know that the internet is not always a reliable place to get information, but it is an easy place. Yeah, I know it's shocking, but I know it is an easy place to get information a lot. And, you know, I found it absolutely amazing. I just went to the old Google machine and asked for a definition of pride. And I have to read this to you because it was absolutely amazing. It says, pride is a high or inordinate opinion of one's own dignity, importance, merit, or superiority, whether as cherished in the mind or as displayed in bearing or conduct. I know I don't have it on the screen for you to be able to see, so I'll kind of sum that up. Basically, what it's defined as is just elevating oneself, having an unmerited and unhealthy elevation of yourself above other people. And you may not say it, you may not act according to that, but it is something that you feel within yourself, that you are superior to other people in one way or maybe even all. That's what the world defines pride as. And of course, we as Christians, we've got to say, we know, even before looking at Scripture, that kind of attitude, that kind of outlook on life, and more specifically, that kind of outlook on ourselves is something that we as Christians can have no part in. We must not have that within ourselves. You know, the Bible is very, very clear about that definition of pride. Again, Proverbs 16 and verse number 18, pride goes before destruction and a haughty spirit before a fall. You know, that was the pride that we saw last week in King Uzziah. Remember, he started out well. Things were going well. He was causing the people of Judah to prosper. Excuse me, let me say that again, but correctly. The Lord was causing the people of Judah to prosper through Uzziah because Uzziah was listening to God, and they had saw great prosperity. But then in, 2 Chronicles chapter 26 and verse number 16, Uzziah, he started to develop pride within himself. And he says, I don't need the priests. I don't need them to do things. I'm going to offer incense to the Lord. And the Lord, of course, taught him a lesson in humility. He was stricken with leprosy, and he had served the rest of his term as king from quarantine. Pride brought him down, and certainly it can bring us down. Proverbs 21 and verse number 4 makes no bones about it at all. It says, a proud heart is sin. Proverbs chapter 6, verses 16 through 18, some verses that are very, very clear, very poignant, and also very, very strong. It says, there are six things the Lord hates, and seven are an abomination to him. And guess what's mentioned in there? A heart of pride. In the New Testament, we continue to read about pride as being something that we must not have in our lives.
First Timothy chapter number 3 and verse number 6 is in the midst of the text where it tells us about the qualification of elders. One of the things that is mentioned by Paul in that text is that elders must not be puffed up with pride. And of course, we know that those are attributes, the attributes given to elders there in 1 Timothy 3 are ones that we should aspire to ourselves. We also know from James chapter 4, verses 1 through 6, that James says that pride promotes strife. It promotes fighting among brethren. And 1 John chapter 2 and verse number 16 gives us three things that are the source of all sin in our lives. Of course, we know the three: the lust of the eye, the lust of the flesh, and what's the third one? The pride of life. And he says those have no part with God. So again, by its very definition, and also by its biblical description, pride is something that we must not have in our lives. Now, I submit to you that the scripture reading we had tonight, 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 through 10, gives us a very good way that we can rid ourselves of pride. If you look at verse number 5, it says, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. And he says, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. And in verses 7 through 10, he continues that discussion, and he tells us how that we can rid ourselves of pride, have humility in our lives, and be exalted by God. But then there's that other side. There's that other side that I've mentioned, and I'd like us to talk about tonight. There's that other side of pride that, if we are realistic and we are honest, that sometimes we use that word pride in a very, very different way. Have we ever found ourselves saying that we are proud of certain things? If you are a parent or a grandparent, I would be very firm in saying, yes, you have. You have said that you're proud of your children. You're proud of their accomplishments. I tell my boys every single day, and I try to without fail, I am proud of them, and I am proud of what they have done. And I'm proud of who they are becoming because they are following the Lord and His Word. We say things like that. We sometimes say that we have a little bit of pride in how we dress. We sometimes say that we have a little bit of pride in how we keep our home. Or we might even say, some of us might even say that we have a little bit of pride in how we take care of this building as a worship place for God. We have a certain amount of pride in how we take care of this. You know, Lee Greenwood even sang about being proud. He said, I am proud to be an American. And we might even say that sometimes it's okay to be proud of the gospel. Remember Romans chapter 1 and verse number 16, Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. And I believe in some ways, in our language in the 21st century, we might say, well, that's a matter of being proud, is it not? We might say, well, that's being proud of the gospel and that you're not ashamed of it. Well, friends, we've got to be very careful about this, but we might say that that is a very colloquial use of the word pride. It is a very different use of it. It is a way that we, in our 21st century English, use that word. And when we say that we are proud of the gospel, it's not saying that we originate the gospel. It is not saying that it is our power that does anything, but it is God's power that accomplishes everything. When we say that we're proud of the way we dress, it's not saying, or we have pride in the way we dress, it's not saying that we are exalting ourselves above other people, but we, in a way, we are dressing nicely so that we are not a stumbling block to others, or that we are presenting the creation of God in a good way. You think about it. Think about it for a moment. Why do we dress nicely for worship service? Why do we put on what some people have come to say over the years to be our Sunday best when we come to worship services? Why do we do that? Because if I'm looking at the same Bible as you are, you know, the Bible does talk about how we dress. The Bible does say something about how we dress, and even the specifics of being together as a Christian family, it does say something about that. Speaking to women in 1 Peter 3, verses 3 and 4, and 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, talks about how that women should not have the braiding of the hair, not be wearing the jewelry, not be wearing the fancy clothing, but yet we wear our Sunday best. You know, James chapter 2, let's not leave the men out of it, James chapter 2 brings about how that it is hypocritical to be showing someone who is wearing nice clothing preference over somebody who is using, and using the language from that, those verses there, wearing shabby clothing. It is very, very clear that we cannot show preferential treatment to somebody based on how they are dressed, whether they are wearing a suit and tie and crisp, clean shirt, or if they're wearing just whatever they've got because they don't have anything better. That's all the Bible says about how we dress. That in some ways we take a matter of pride in presenting ourselves in our best for the Lord. Are we sinning? Are we showing godless pride? Are we showing self-pride by doing this? Well, we've got to ask ourselves that question. What about in our taking pride in taking care of this building? We've got to ask ourselves. You know, as we take care of this building, and I commend so many members of this congregation who spend tireless hours, much, much great effort in coming and making sure this building is clean, it is presentable, making sure that the grass outside is mowed, making sure that the plants outside are growing and being taken care of. Are we being prideful in doing such by having a feeling of gratitude about the way things look? Because, you know, we've got to ask ourselves, if we were to have dirt on the floor instead of vacuuming, would we not be able to worship God? If we were to have dust on the back of the pews, instead of wiping them down regularly, will we not be able to worship God? You know, I think about the example of those in the New Testament where they worshiped, the conditions in which they worshiped. We recently talked about Paul in Ephesus and how that he was a tent maker there and how that he even worked out of a home and worked out of a shop there. Do you think there was dust on the floor? Yes, there was. But yet he was able to do the will of God there. What about just a few chapters before that, instead of Acts 18, going back to Acts chapter 16? In what condition did Paul worship? In which, what condition did Paul pray? In which, what condition did Paul find himself as he sang praises to God? Well, we know from Acts chapter 16, he's in Philippi. He found himself having to go out to a riverside to pray to the Lord, and that's where he met Lydia, the seller of purple. And later in that very same chapter, we find out that he's singing praise to God like we do on every Sunday and every Wednesday. He's with Silas, and he's singing praise to God, but the floors weren't swept and the furniture wasn't dusted because he was in handcuffs. He was cuffed. He was a man who was in a prison. You know, where he was made no difference. But why do we, in some ways, take pride in taking care of this building? You know, we've got to ask ourselves these things, friends. Am I going to criticize anyone for dressing nicely to worship? Absolutely not, because I would have to be the first one to be guilty if so. Would I criticize anyone for taking care of this building? Absolutely not. Would I criticize anyone for taking care of their home? Absolutely not. Would we criticize anyone for taking pride in their children? Absolutely not. If we define pride as we should in another way. And here's why. Sometimes we aren't able to see certain things in life, but we need to make a judgment about them, or sometimes we want to make a judgment about them, and we only use what we can see to tell us things about what we cannot see. Let me give you a simple example of that. Have you ever gone to a new restaurant or ever been going to a new restaurant you've never been to before? I'm not talking about a new one as in it's freshly built, but just one that's new to you. You've never gone to that place before. Have you ever gone to a new restaurant and been a little bit nervous about going in? I'm not talking about nervous because you're afraid it's a little bit too expensive, or nervous because you're not sure whether you're going to like the food, but nervous about whether or not you should actually eat the food that's at that place. Because if there's one thing that we cannot see in a lot of restaurants, it's the cooking conditions. It's the kitchen in which the food is being prepared. And think about that. And I don't mean to put off anybody who wants to go out to eat tonight. Sorry about this, but I may. But just think about it. When you go to a restaurant, what are you putting inside your body? Something that somebody else's hands have touched. Something that somebody else's hands have handled and prepared. You're trusting that they're washing the dishes, they're cleaning the counters, that they're not cross-contaminating with all different things. And friends, I worked in the food industry many years ago, if you can call fast food the food industry. But I worked in the food industry many years ago, and I would not eat a lot of the things from the places I worked at. Because I saw it. How do we know, as people who are going to eat at a restaurant, that the kitchen is going to be clean and we're not going to have contaminated food? Well, again, the Google machine comes to the rescue, and it tells us that there have been studies that have shown that if you want to know the conditions of the kitchen in the restaurant, then you must first go to the restroom of the restaurant. Now, that sounds a little backwards, especially when you go to Taco Bell, but it is absolutely true. If you want to know the conditions of the kitchen, go to the restroom of the restaurant. Because studies have shown consistently that in restaurants where they take care of the restroom, they have it clean, organized, well-stocked, and free of contamination, then that is very indicative of the conditions of the kitchen. So if you go in there and it's clean, organized, and sanitary and everything, you can be more assured that the kitchen is going to be the same way, and thus your food will be the same way. That's at least what the Google machine says. And you may say, well, Scott, what does that have to do with anything? Well, friends, sometimes we use what we can see to pass judgment on things that we cannot. And, friends, we need to make sure that we are aware of that in our lives. You know, take a look at it, if you would. Hold your place there in 1 Peter 5. We'll go back. But take a look with me at a couple places in Scripture. Turn to John chapter 13 with me, if you would, please. John chapter number 13. You know, sometimes we end up being guilty, I guess I should say, of sometimes passing judgment on things that we cannot see based on what we can. Have you ever been cut off in traffic on I-35 and said, well, you know, that person's a maniac driving like that? Well, no, maybe that person's in an emergency. Can we judge things based on what we see, judge what we cannot see based on what we can? Well, sometimes we do that, and sometimes it's incorrect, but sometimes there are judgments passed on what we can see, judging what we cannot be seen. Take a look at John chapter 13 and verse number 35. This is Jesus speaking. Notice what he says here. He says, by this all will know that you are my disciples, if you have love one for another. A verse that we know very well. But notice what he's saying there. He's saying that people can look at us, see something about us, the way we act, if we have love for one another, and be able to tell from what they see whether or not what they cannot see is true or not. They cannot see whether we are Christians or not on our inside. But he says on the outside, they'll be able to tell something about you. Flip over a few more pages to John chapter 17. John chapter 17, in the midst of Jesus' prayer before he goes to the cross. Notice what it said in verse number 21. He's praying. Let's look back up to verse 20. He says, I do not pray for these alone, but for all those also who believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us. Why? That the world may believe that you sent me. You know, people can't see Jesus today. We can't see him except for hearing his word. But Jesus said that they're going to take something, the world's going to take something they can see to make judgment on something they cannot see. They're going to look at us. They're going to look at Christianity. And if we are one, we are unified, then they will be able to tell that he is true, that he was sent by the Lord. And friends, it is along that same line that sometimes we take pride, to use that colloquial term, in how we dress. You know, yes, the Bible says that we need to just dress respectably. We need to dress in ways that are not revealing, I guess you could say, in some ways. The Bible does not tell us we have to wear our Sunday best. But we take respect of this. We take pride in some ways of this because people are going to look at this and say, well, if they're not dressing in respect for God, but yet we see them out at work or out at a wedding, out at a funeral, out at this other event, dressing out of respect for a man, what kind of respect for God do they have if they show up in not very nice apparel? Well, again, that's not exactly, it is definitely not a equivalent assumption or a good assumption they're making. But yet some of us also look at our lives. If I give honor to a man by dressing this way in one situation, I'd better give the same honor to God. We make that assumption, or we make that conclusion. What about our homes? What about this building here? Why do we take care of the building? Why do we take care of the grounds? Because again, some people may see what they can see here in the building and say, well, they may pass a judgment on what they cannot see. If they're not taking care of the building, Will they take care of my soul if I go there? Again, we think about things like this. The Apostle Paul did. If you look at 1 Corinthians 9, verses 19 and following, I believe it is, you know, the Apostle Paul, he was very careful with his appearance. He was very careful with how he handled himself as he went into different places. He says that to the Jews, I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though not being under the law myself, that I might win those under the law. And he continues on through verse number 22. He said he was very cognizant of it. So he was very aware of the air that he was putting off. He was of the example he was giving. And that's why we dress nice. That's why we take care of the building. Because sometimes people make judgments on what they cannot see based on what they can. Well, again, what does this have to do with pride? Well, friends, when we start dressing nicely for Sunday, we've got to ask ourselves, am I doing this to promote the Lord? Am I doing this to help somebody not have a stumbling block? Or am I doing this to promote myself? We've got to ask ourselves that question. When we take care of our homes, we've got to ask ourselves, am I doing this to honor and be a good steward of what God has given me? Or am I doing this for the praise of man, for myself, and myself alone? We've got to ask ourselves why in each of these situations. And friends, going back to 1 Peter chapter 5, looking at verses 6 through 10, I believe we're given several things here that teach us how to have the type of humility we need to have to get rid of foolish pride, bringing attention to self, and have the type of humility that brings attention to God. Again, looking at verses 6 through 10, after he says in verse 5, God resists the proud but gives grace to the humble, he says, therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you in due time. You know, getting rid of pride, first and foremost, we must have humility. Secondly, in verse number 7, he says, not only must we have humility to get rid of pride, we've got to have trust. We've got to have trust in God. He says, casting all your care upon him. Why? Because he cares for you. Sometimes pride in ourselves causes us to hold certain things back. Sometimes pride in ourselves causes us to say, well, I'm just going to deal with this myself. I will take care of this problem myself. No, Peter says, no, give it to God. Cast your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Verse number 8. He says, not only must we have humility and we must have trust, he says we must also have awareness in order to get rid of pride. He's still talking the same vein. He says, be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about as a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. We've got to have awareness. Awareness of self and our own temptations, and awareness of the environment and the devil's trickery in the area. We've got to have awareness. Verse number 9, we've got to have resistance to that temptation. He continues it. He says, resist him, steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood and the world. And along with that resistance, we need to have fellowship, understanding that we are tempted all in the same way, each together, 1 Corinthians 10:13. And then finally, in verse number 10, in order to get rid of the pride and have this humility, we understand that there will be some suffering involved with it. He says, but may the God of all grace who called us into his eternal glory, called us into his eternal glory by Christ Jesus, after you have suffered a while, perfect, establish, strengthen, and settle you. Notice what he says there in the second half of the verse. He says that after you have suffered a while, you'll be perfected, established, strengthened, and settled. You know, trying to get rid of pride, it may be difficult. There's going to be problems. There's going to be suffering. But at the same time, if we can trust in God, be aware of the environment and the trickery of Satan around us, resist that, and have humility and give it to God, we will be exalted. He says you'll be perfected, established, strengthened, and settled. Friends, tonight, the lesson is yours. This was something that, you know, I struggled greatly with this week, trying to understand what the best way to present this, knowing what is the best thing to be said. And in that thought, just leaving it up to the Bible and letting the Bible say what it does is the best thing to be done. Pride in self is something that we must get rid of. But satisfaction in the Lord is something that we must have. We must have that humility. We must have that trust. We must have that awareness. And even though we will have suffering, we will have establishment in the Lord. We must give it to him. And tonight, if there's any need that you have spiritually, if there's anything that we can help you with, we'd be glad to help.
Or if you are not a Christian and you'd like to be baptized into Christ for the remission of your sins, let us know how we can help you tonight as we stand and sing.
Who at the door is standing, patiently drawing near, entrance within demanding, whose is the voice I hear? Sweetly the tones are calling, open the door for me, if thou wilt heed my calling, I will abide with thee. All through the dark hour dreary, knocking again is he. Jesus, art thou not weary, waiting so long for me? Sweetly the doors are calling, open the door for me, if thou wilt heed my calling, I will abide with thee. Door of my heart, I hasten, thee will I open wide, though he rebuke and chasten, he shall with me abide. Sweetly the tones are calling, open the door for me, if thou wilt heed my calling, I will abide with thee.
Be seated, please. Do we have anyone here this evening that desires to partake of the Lord's Supper? I don't see anyone. All right, then I guess we're ready for our announcements.
Scott, thanks for a good lesson on that. Pride is always a tricky topic. And if that's the only pride you didn't talk about, was the pride of lions. And if you have that type of pride in your life, there's probably another set of issues you have to deal with. So carrying on from this morning, no real updates, although Brother Ron Bentley was dealing with some blood pressure issues, and they stayed at home this evening just to help him kind of get his blood pressure down just a little bit, rest up. Hopefully the medicine adjustments that he's going through will kind of get him back into a good spot. Have a note from Cliff and Sandy Roberts. They're asking for prayers for Cliff's older brother, Ted Roberts, who's in critical care at Kansas City Hospital with a kidney infection. He was admitted last night and is responding well to medications at this time, but please keep him in your prayers and that he will have a quick and full recovery. We also received a card from Brother LaShawn for the graduation meal this afternoon. The card says, I appreciate every single one of the gifts, monetary donations, and wonderful cards with beautiful words in them. In these past years, I have come to grow into the God-fearing man I am today. All thanks to my wonderful brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you all so much for being such a wonderful family. Love, LaShawn Nelson. Thank you for that. We had a great time this afternoon. It was a really great meal. Appreciate all the hard work that went into preparing for that. And for all those who got to stay, we had some really good food, really good fellowship, and really good desserts as well. Again, a reminder that in June, we're switching to the new groups. The groups are posted in the foyer on the bulletin board. And the 4th of June will be Group 1 Fellowship. And Brother Phil Granato, I don't have an update on him other than he was He stayed at home this weekend because of being in the hospital over the week with a low sodium that was dangerously low, and they ran some tests on him, and hopefully he'll be able to be back with us soon. And those are really, other than the other announcements of the folks that are dealing with medical issues and recovery and things like that, those are all the announcements we have at this time. Please be standing as we have our closing song and closing prayer.
For the closing song, number 169. 169, Have Thine Own Way.
Have Thine Own Way, Lord, have Thine Own Way. Thou art the Potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after Thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have Thine Own. Just now, as in Thy presence, humbly I bow. Have Thine own way, Lord, have Thine own way. Hold o'er my being absolute sway. Fill with Thy Spirit. Till all shall see Christ only always living in me.
We thank you, Father, for allowing each and every one of us to be a part of this brand new day, to come and worship you in truth and spirit, dear Heavenly Father. We come this evening, dear Heavenly Father, asking prayer for all of those that need it, sick and the shut in, the families that have lost loved ones, the families that are traveling up and down the dangerous highways. We pray, dear Heavenly Father, that if it's your will, you give each and every one of them the thing that they stand in need of, dear Heavenly Father. And dear Heavenly Father, we just continue to ask prayer for this congregation. We ask that the brothers, that the brothers here continue to do your will, to teach your will. And as we leave this place, but not your presence, dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you continue to be with each and every one of us. And these prayers we offer up in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.